Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him.
Never see. before we ask you for anything, we first want to say we're sorry. We're sorry, Lord, if we did not praise you like we ought to have. That our worship may have been perfunctory. We're sorry, Lord, if we came sliding in here just giving you just a little pity bat a pat of praise. We're sorry, Lord, if our hearts and minds were not in it. But Lord, we're coming tonight to make restitution. We're coming tonight, Lord, because we know, Lord, we do not deserve all that we have. But you are a gracious God. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity that we might share in this 192nd session of this annual conference. We thank you, Lord, that all year long you were with us, that you pulled us up, set us up, stood by us, and in many cases picked us up. Lord, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for being that answer to the prayers that we pray. We thank you for helping us make a way out of no way. We thank you, Lord, when the week was longer than the salary. We thank you, Lord, that you provided for us. We thank you, Lord, that you brought us out of the midst of darkness into the marvelous light. We thank you. We ask you, Lord, that now you make your presence known to us. That as we share in this worship experience, that your power might come upon us.
Yes.
Oh Lord, let the Holy Spirit reign on us tonight. Go to each and every chair and pew and down each and every aisle and sweep the altar and the choir, Lord. Let us, Lord, not just see the fire, but feel the fire, Lord. Help us, Lord, that we might be connected as one community, worshiping together. You are our agenda item today. Oh, Lord, bless the preacher, we pray, that the words that have been prepared, Lord, are just what we need to hear and just what we need to move and do something different than we've ever done before. Oh, Lord, bless us, we pray, and we'll be so careful to give all the glory, honor, and praise. Oh, Lord, this is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. O magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from all my fears. They looked unto him, and were lightened, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him, and saved him out of all his troubles.
Yeah.
The angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him, and delivereth him. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him. The word of God for the people of God.
When the opportunity arises to give a sacrificial offer of $10,
I always get with a glad heart, because there are people that are hungry that need to be fed. There are people that are without clothes that need to be clothed. There are people that need to be loved and cared for, and we have the opportunity and the blessing to do so. And so I was able to go back to my good fried chicken and buy another $10 meal.
I would like to know the address of where Reverend Robinson can get four chickens and biscuits from a Kentucky Fried Chicken for $10. You just let us know that. I'll put that out so that everybody can know where that is. Amen. Bishop Philip R. Cousins, Sr., Bishop Reginald T. Jackson,
good.
Associate Presiding Elders, Pastors, Delegates, all those assembled here for this 192nd session of the New York Annual Conference, it is my honor and privilege to be able to present our Episcopal leader. I've really looked into the rules of protocol, and the rules of protocol actually say that the less you say about somebody, the more important they are. But I'll just tag that a little bit and say that what I'm enjoying about our bishop, if I can say this without anybody getting too twisted, is that he's just a regular guy. He likes a good laugh, likes to have fun, not heavy-handed, not oppressive, compassionate, graceful, and even in his discipline and correction,
loving.
He kind of talks in this kind of soft, deep voice where you can see and sense his compassion, but you know you better listen to what he's saying. So I'm honored and privileged tonight to present the 118th elected and consecrated bishop of the African Methodist Episcopal Church, Bishop Gregory Gerald McKinley Ingram. Won't you stand and give God praise for our Episcopal.
Thank you, Dr. Wilson. I want to pull that up, what you said about protocol. That's a good line. I thank you. To His Eminence Bishop Reginald Thomas Jackson, give the bishop a big hand. Praise the Lord. All these distinguished presiding elders, and to our Episcopal supervisor, Reverend Dr. Jessica Eileen Kendall Ingram. Amen. And to our host pastor and his lovely wife, the Whoopers. Now, listen, give them a big hand. Now, Dr. Wilson stole part of my line I was going to use. I'm going to talk about this disclaimer. But I don't want to know just the address. That wasn't the hood, man. Or in my neighborhood, they would take your car. You need a checkbook and the money and all that. They take you. Kentucky Fried Chicken. It must have been some mighty good chicken. Somebody say amen. Beloved, it's my distinct privilege and pleasure to present a person who really needs no introduction. And I'd like to use the line in Teddy Pendergrass. If you don't know him by now, you never really know him. Let me say a couple of things. Because this bishop was one who inspired me years ago. Even before he became a bishop, and I remember distinctly one time when he was running, aspiring for the bishopry. It was about 1975, I think, at Bethlehem Church.
He came and preached a sermon. I won't tell the sermon itself because you might preach it later on. But I'm telling you, he had a hair full of hair. I mean, a head full of hair. I mean, he had a big throat. grease the horns off of Billy Coon. I was so inspired by his prophetic word. But I know something else about his ministry. And all you had to do was just, you know, where he got elected from, St. Joseph, there in Durham. I mean, just a powerful preacher. And he comes from a preaching family. He just has it in his roots. Graduate of Central State University. That's right next to Wilberforce. That's why he's right next to Wilberforce. That's right next to Wilberforce. He went to Central State. Then he got his doctorate from Colgate Pink, Rochester. He also went to BU. And I'm telling you, I looked in the Jet magazine, and this was one of the pioneers who, along with a lot of distinguished preachers in this country. But I remember that, and I cut that out because I had a connection with him. And I said to people that I got inspired through stewardship, principally because of him, Wyatt and Walk, a couple of people. I can go on and on to talk about Bishop Philip Robert Cook. He has been a champion called a lot of young preachers.
I'm telling you, a lot of people are in this church today where they are today because he had a hand with it. He touched a lot of people. So I thank the Lord for Bishop Philip Robert Cook. He has five sons, all preachers. Matter of fact, his great grandson, who's just about 1 year old, all preachers. But I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, when you look back over his career, his life, what he's done, he's been a major pivotal person in this church. A churchman. One who knows all the various intricacies about the church. And so we're blessed tonight. Decided to be in the first Episcopal district. Did a great work. And then went to the fourth district. I'm telling you, he has been a blessing to African Methodism and been a blessing to Reverend Justin. Been a blessing to me. As a matter of fact, it's been a blessing to all you all and visit Texas. So it becomes my pleasure to present somebody who's been a major blessing in my life, and I know in yours. Since he was up in this area, I thought that we all needed to hear another word from the Lord. Anybody need a word from the Lord? Come on, let's stand on our feet and let's put our hands together. For the 1960s,
when he died. Oh! God's praise for an hour.
Hallelujah.
Let me thank Bishop Gregory Engel for his kindness, for his open spirit, for the very visionary mind that he has for the expansion of our Zion, for the growth and development of Christendom through African Methodists. So I want to thank him for what he has done and does not yet fear what he shows, and how God shall use him, how God will let him become the point person for kingdom building here in the first. So to his very supportive and independent wife, who does not stand in his shadow, but casts her own.
Amen.
Reverend Dr. Jessica Ingram. I'm delighted to be with Reginald Jackson.
Amen. Amen.
Bishop Reginald Jackson.
Amen.
You ought to be thankful. He's from here. Here with Bishop Jackson and to see how he is unfolding with grace and goodness,
yes,
and becoming, evolving into the kind of Reverend Father in God that will make all of the church proud of him,
yes,
for his stance and his attitude and his hopeful looking. Thank God for him.
Yes.
I'm happy to see all the elders, see all the pastors, all of the spouses and all the laypersons here in the first district. I could not come here and see somebody before and not say how glad I am to see Dr. Darrell Williams, who is a pastor of St. Mark Daily Church in Milwaukee. I know he's there because I sent him. I know he is there. I know that's where he is. To have the candidate for Episcopal honors, and I see he's getting around. Glad to have you here. And happy I'll tell the folks back home that I saw you when I was here. So it's good to be here. My wife sends her greetings. My wife says she is retired. I am not. She says she is retired. If we retire, you retire. So we have grandchildren here. If you have grandchildren and great grandchildren here, then you know they kind of top the chart. And so she sends her well wishes and her greetings and her love to you for all that you've done and how you have helped bless us and kept us where we are. So I am pleased to greet you tonight in the matchless name of Jesus. His love never fails. His joy is unspeakable. And his grace is more than sufficient to cover all of our needs. So get his love and fill with his joy, and I'm thankful for his grace. And come giving God glory, giving God honor, giving God praise for allowing us one more time to come and break bread around the altar. Remember who it was that died for us so that we might have a right to everlasting life. I'm thankful and I'm grateful that God has given us this privilege. When we were growing up, we were taught manners. Every home, you were taught how to act, how to be kind, how to speak to folks, how to be courteous, how to be respectful. Don't get out of your place. There's one special kind of manners that we were taught. How you came to the table. You never came to the table with dirty hands. Before you went to eat, you had to wash your hands. You had to make sure that you were clean. make sure your hands are finished. And you never came to the table and tried to take somebody else's seat. You had to respect the head of the house. You had to give respect to the house. And so tonight we come to ask you a question. How are your table manners? I'd like to talk to you tonight about your table manners. From St. Paul's first epistle to the Corinthians, the 11th chapter, and I'm reading the 27th and 28th verses. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be answerable for the body and blood of the Lord. Examine yourself, and only then eat of the bread and drink of the cup. How are your table manners? This is God's house. God is the head of this house. When we come to this table, when we come to partake of this food that God had made through the sacrifice of his son, Christ Jesus, we must ask ourselves, do we have the right manners? Have we been taught properly? What kind of table manners do we have? Well, preacher, tell me. Well, we're invited all the time with the right kind of manners. And then let me tell you where it begins. Ye that do truly and earnestly repent of your sin. Now, the first table manner you've ever had when you come here, have you repented? I mean, have you truly repented? Are you truly sorry for your mistakes, for your blunders, for your shortcomings, for how many times you messed up and how many times you had the wrong attitude and how many times you fell out of place? How many times you've fallen? Have you really truly and earnestly repented? Can you say, God, I give myself to you. I'm coming to your table tonight. Truly repent. I'm sorry for the hard words I said. I'm sorry for the bad attitude I had. I'm sorry for all the things I've done. I'm coming to the table truly and earnestly repent of my sin. I laid myself on the altar and asked, give me grace, give me glory, give me strength, give me forgiveness, forgive me, forgive me, forgive me for all that I've done. I truly and earnestly people. You may made the slightest mistake and you would die. There was a young couple that wanted to get married. But the young man made a mistake. And Cromwell told the young man, tonight, when the bell rings for curfew, as we stand in the city square, you'll be condemned to die. The young lady pleaded with Cromwell, but Cromwell wouldn't hear it. He said, I'm sorry. He was wrong. He must die. That night, they gathered in the courtyard, waiting for the bell to ring. The bell ringer climbed the tower, pulled the rope. Nothing happened.
Well,
pulled it again. Nothing happened. Climbed up into the bell tower to see what was wrong. Why didn't the bell ring? And there, holding on to the clapper for the bell, was the young lady.
All right.
She held on so tight that every time he pulled the rope, her body hit the side of the bell. He pulled again and her body hit the side of the bell. And Cromwell said, anybody who loves that much, loves that much, young man, go free. Well, that's how much God loved us. Messing up all the time. give all to him.
Come on, let's give this a turn.